So this is a paper on multi-attribute risk aversion and charitable giving. It's a more academic paper than we've been having here, but I want to explain why I think some of this more formal structure may be useful for practitioners eventually. And not immediately, but eventually. Why you should have a balanced portfolio of interest in immediate bottom line results and also some structure. And I should stress that this is joint with three brilliant co-authors, all from Monash University in Melbourne, Australia, my hometown, my home university. None of them are on the market, but if they are, you should just hire them. They're very, very smart. We initially started talking about this work a couple of years ago, and we were interested in the topic I'm about to talk to you about, and I said, well, this is you know, how the theory is laid out, and it's really, really going to be hard to identify this, to design the structure. And I came back a year later, and they had a design laid out, and I said, yeah, what about this? And they said, oh, well, we handled it that way. And I said, what about that? I said, well, that's actually a good question. We handled it this way. So it's one of those situations where they really solve some very, very important puzzles, and I want to give you a flavor for that today. So the broader objectives of what I'm doing here, which I'm not going to deliver, but I want to contrast a little bit with the flavor of other valuable things that have been presented at this this conference, is that we're really interested in the welfare economics of charitable contributions. What explains them in a structural sense, not in a black box sense. I'm not a part of the causality police. It's not as if I want to say I can attach a behavioral economist label to something, and we see the effect of it, and that's enough. I want to understand it in terms of something that really is theory, not just a, you know, hand-waving theory labeling. Do these patterns reflect cognitive biases? That's the topic of this session, and it's actually a very, very deep question for the one that I'm eventually going to get to next. Are charitable contributions always normatively good things? John said earlier, one of the focuses of this conference, which is fine, is on the positive economics of selling a can of beans. It's just marketing. It's just behavioral marketing. Can we frankly get somebody to give more money to charity X? Charity Y be damned, the welfare effects of that be damned. We're not interested in that question, and that's perfectly legitimate. Nothing. No. And I know that you have internalized in your household much in behavioral marketing. In fact, I think it's very sophisticated, but I would differentiate it from the stuff that economists do. But I don't want to get into too many doctrinal lines there. Essentially, what we're seeing in a lot of the applications here, with an important exception that I want to raise in a moment, is people saying, what about this? What about that? Let's try it. Does it increase the bottom line? That's a perfectly honorable task. And as we discussed last night with David and others, it involves rigor. It involves randomization to identify causal statements. So there's a lot of serious science involved there. I want to complement that with some structural models as to what might be going on here. A number of papers have talked about the cognitive biases that have led people to make contributions or not make contributions. They've attempted to identify them. They've attempted to measure them. If there are cognitive biases, and Uri, this goes straight to the normative aspects of advertising for an economist, then we can ask, is it a good thing that you trick this person into somehow giving more money to this charity? If you work for this charity, you care about the bottom line, you've got a very, very simple social welfare function. If we have a broader evaluation function, even for the individual, ex post, do they feel as if they were tricked in some sense? That's getting into slippery waters for economists when we start talking about the effects of advertising, the malleability of preferences, because what are the true preferences? So I'm not trying to pretend that we can resolve that, but I want us to be aware of that, because that's actually what makes marketing and advertising an extraordinarily fundamental question for economists to pay attention to. So I want us eventually to get there, that's what I'm saying. And this is a small step in that direction. The more narrow aspect here is we want to think of charitable contributions as lotteries. When you give a certain amount of money to a charity, you don't know exactly what's going to happen. What's going to happen is a lottery, and the word lottery to economists, of course, is just a metaphor for there's going to be some risk in terms of whether this charitable outcome obtains or that charitable outcome obtains, or the manager flies first class and you don't see much of the money actually going to the final recipients. It's a lottery in that sense. We don't quite know. People can claim that they're telling you what's going to happen to the money, But they usually, they don't know themselves in as precise a sense as we often represent. So we want to pick up on that question of thinking of charitable contributions as a lottery from the point of view of the donor. And then we're led to ask a couple of natural questions. What is the subjective perception of risk? What's the role played by these metric organizations that are ranking different charities? I know several people have looked at this question, and it's becoming a very big issue in terms of some of the large donations that are being given, people who are ranking the efficacy of this charity as against another one, its efficiency in terms of it, the overhead structure and so forth. What's the subjective perception of charities that leads people to view them as this lottery rather than that lottery? Secondly, once we're dealing with a lottery, of course, this is part and parcel, this is meat and potatoes for economists. Do people have an aversion to risk or a love of risk? Do they like skewness? What's their preferences over the risk attributes of this charitable lottery? And then how do they evaluate each of the lottery alternatives? Is it in a subjective expected utility manner? Is it in a rank-dependent manner? Is it in a prospect-theoretic manner? That's a completely legitimate series of questions to ask. So we're not going to answer any of those questions, but that's the broad picture that this research program is gained at. What we are going to focus on here, though, is the recognition that very few charities are unidimensional. That is, they do one thing. They often do several things. And indeed, it might be just the localization of the product that's provided. It could be something that's a state charity in terms of the outcomes to one state, or it could be national. That's an attribute. It could be that they're providing several attributes. And the critical thing is, in the mind of the donor, are they providing several attributes? Are they perceived that way by the donor? That's the main focus of what we're going to do here. So we want to develop a language and a lab experiment to help us define these issues. What do we mean by this? I'm going to focus initially just on a lab experiment, not because those of you who know me, I'm as much an advocate of field experiments as anybody in the room. I always do lab experiments as a complement to field experiments. Frankly, it's a lot of work to go out and do a field experiment. A lot of things can go wrong. I want to try things out in the wind tunnel called the lab. So I don't want to stop in the lab. I'm going to stop today in the lab, but I don't want to stop there eventually. I want to be sure that I've got all my ducks, the conceptual ducks, the instructional ducks, the data ducks lined up in the lab where I've got the cleanest possible beakers to be mixing various treatments and various components, and then I'll take it out into the field. Also, we want to look at risk attitudes and charitable contribution choices. I'm going to assume away now, and we're going to induce these in the lab. So we're going to assume away the subjective risk perceptions question. That's a very interesting and separate question I don't want to ignore, but I will now for the interest of getting on with something that we can contribute to. And look at the multi-attribute nature of charitable outcomes. So let's get down to the specifics about what the charity is. I want to tell you about the charity. I want to tell you a little bit quickly about the tasks, the choices that our subjects made. Then I'll put a bit of theory on that. Once you see the tasks, you can kind of see the relevance of the theory. Then I'll tell you how we can identify the structural parameters of interest. So WaterAid operates in 17 countries around the world. It does a whole bunch of things in terms of water. And these are just random pictures drawn from, if you Google WaterAid, you know, images associated with WaterAid, that's a slew of things that come on up. So broadly defined, there's quite a few attributes here. There's not just two, and I am going to boil it down to two in a second. One is the region it's located in. It's not Chicago. Okay? So the region it's located in, you might care about India and Africa. You may care more about Timor-Leste. You may care about different countries. So that's an attribute to the donor. So that's one aspect. The second aspect is they often look at sheer provision of water. They dig stuff. They dig wells, and they make wells available. So water scarcity is a big factor, one of the big attributes that WaterAid produces. The other thing they worry about is water quality, both in terms of education and also providing better quality water in many, many settings. So those are just three of the attributes, and we're going to focus on the scarcity, the providing access to water in places that don't have it, and the sanitation, the quality of the water. Everything we're doing can be extended to more than two attributes, so there's nothing essential in that. So here's the design. We're first of all going to elicit risk attitudes over money. That's a familiar task for us and economists. We're then going to focus, this is the novelty stuff here, let's focus on two of the attributes of the donations to water aid, water scarcity providing it and the quality of the water. They're kind of natural two attributes to focus on. We want to present subjects with lottery choices in which we only vary one attribute, and then a series of choices where we only vary the other attribute, and then a series of choices where we vary both. That's the general logic. I'm going to take you through that logic in terms of the displays and in terms of how it connects to theory in a moment. But that's the general logic here. And then we're going to select a choice and make the implied charitable donation out of experimental funds. One of the features of this experiment I won't talk about here, we just don't have time, is we then did a subsequent exercise where the subjects donated their own money and there were contributions out of their own money and we elicited the same choices. So right now, let's just focus on the simplest design where you're making choices and the experimenter is making a donation on your behalf. Okay? Yep. Absolutely. So, yeah, so there's a compound lottery here. That's the point you're getting at. To what extent can they trust us? We actually gave them access to websites to look at water aid and so forth, but how much do you trust the website? And this is of great significance in a lot of the field experiments I'm doing. We're doing a lot of work in portfolios of the Atlanta poor. They're looking at the Atlanta poor, black urban poor in sub-Saharan Africa. And they say that there are three ingredients to French cooking, butter, butter, and butter. There are three ingredients to doing work in poor neighborhoods and in sub-Saharan Africa, corruption, corruption, and corruption. And you've simply got to allow for that. So I take that very seriously, and the credibility is a significant issue as you take it to the field. But let's just take that as assumed. And we're going to assume further that we have indeed induced the risk perceptions. The way to handle that would be to say, here's all the information. Now, you're going to be able to go to a website or some other site to verify it. Let's assume that there is such a site. I want to elicit your beliefs that the information I gave you is correct, and I'll reward you on that in ways that you and I know you can reward people. Okay, here's the task. This was a fairly easy one in terms of money. People choose this lottery or this lottery. Here's showing you the amount of money you get with 20% chance and with 80% chance. And you can choose option A or option B. This is a familiar task. Sorry? Here they are. Well, the other guys did that. I don't know how to do these things in C3, so they're very impressive. Here's the new one, though. Here's one that this. So I'll go slowly on this and show you some details because, you know, the fonts are a little bit small. So here's, I'm just going backwards now. Here's the one on money. So we've got a risky outcome here and a risky outcome here. You select option A or option B. If this choice is selected, we play it out and you get the money. Now when we move to sanitation, we've explained in the instructions what we mean by sanitation. So I'm just going to use the generic term sanitation units. Okay? You'd need to read the instructions to know what that means. And we've explained that to the subjects, and we have to assume that they understand that what that means in terms of, you know, gallons of water per person delivered, okay? But you've got a lottery here between, just defined over sanitation unit outcomes. So there's one where you get a lot of sanitation or very little. That's one where this is the relatively safe lottery. This is the risky lottery on the right-hand side. Let me give you a detail. This is a detail on option A. So you can actually see what the subject sees is with a 20% chance in yellow, they're going to have that outcome in terms of supply of water, quality units, and here with an 80% outcome. And this says, due to the donation made by the experiment, there is a chance of 5 life months gained, and we've explained what we mean by life months. You just have to accept that for the moment, and you have to read the instructions to see how we've explained that. Is 20%. Alternatively, there's an 80% chance that there'll only be 4 life months gained in terms of the improved sanitation from the donation. Okay? So as we move to water scarcity, which we also call security, you get a similar choice now. So here's the safe lottery over water security. Here's the risky lottery over water security. And you can see here we've got chance of 5 people gaining water security is 50%. Chance of 4 people gaining water security. So those are the units of outcomes we've explained in the instructions. So those are the single attribute lotteries. for this attribute and that attribute. Now, and I'll show you a detail on this one. This is the novelty. This is where we're varying both our attributes. I should do that for the cameras. There we go. My co-authors are watching, so they, there we go. You got that on record. Let me expand this one up. So basically, what I want you to see in the big picture here, and then I'll expand this so you can actually read it, is we're varying water security and sanitation here and here. Here you've got a good outcome in water security, a lousy outcome in sanitation. Here you've got a lousy outcome in security and a good outcome in sanitation. Here you've got good, good, and bad, bad. We'll come back to why we've structured it that way in a second. Here's a detail. So basically, they're choosing a 40% chance of this outcome or a 60% chance of that outcome. That's option A, okay? Let's connect this to the theory. Let's connect this to theory, and I'll go back now and show you how it relates to the displays. Okay, this is also Australian notation. It's very simple. We don't use too many of these Greek symbols. There are two attributes, X and Y. Little X is smaller than big X. Little, big, get it? Little X, big X. They don't get it. So X is one attribute, and Y is the other one. That's sanitation. We'll define a lottery alpha as a 50-50 mix of poor outcome of X, good outcome of Y, or a good outcome of X and a bad outcome of Y. So that's where you're spreading the risk in term across the attributes. Here, lottery beta, you've either got a bad outcome of scarcity and a bad outcome of sanitation, or with some probability, you've got a good outcome in both. So this lottery beta is where the extremes, you get the extreme outcomes. Lottery alpha is your safe lottery, but defined across attributes. That's the novelty here. It's not new to us. This theory has been around for 50, 60 years. So we're just, so here's the point. If you don't care about lottery alpha and beta, you're said to be multi-attribute or multivariate risk averse. You don't care about the spread of outcomes across attributes, okay? If you prefer alpha to beta for all values of these things, if you prefer this guy to this guy, you're said to be multi-attribute risk averse. You don't want, what you want to do is, you want to avoid these extremes. That's the point. Then you go to lottery alpha. If you're multi-attribute risk-loving, you'll go to beta over alpha. So these are standard definitions in the literature. You can actually see now our design, the design I just showed you, there's your lottery alpha, there's your lottery beta. Beta, remember, was big X, big Y, little X, little Y. There's your big X, your little Y, your little X, your big Y. So it's literally a translation of that theoretical definition that's used to test for multi-attribute risk aversion. I've only got 5 minutes. This is an important point. Let me make this point. We say that an agent's multi-attribute risk averse if this mixed derivative, the off-diagonal of the Hessian, is negative. Notice, you can be multi-attribute risk averse even if you are single-attribute risk neutral or over one attribute, or single attribute risk-loving over the other attribute. The two are not connected. You can have one attitude to the variability of water sanitation, one attitude to the variability of water scarcity, but when I'm talking about combining them both, you could have an entirely different qualitative attitude, okay? All right, running out of time. So we've got 154 subjects in the lab. They each made 40 decisions. I've gone over these, 10 in each ones. And then the average contribution to water aid of 1522 made on behalf of the subjects. We had a monitor verify that was actually done. Here's the econometric model. We have to have a non-additively separable expected utility because it turns out, theoretically, if you're multi-attribute risk averse, you must have a non-additive... No, that's actually correct. Your additive utility, if and only if, you're multi-attribute risk neutral. Error. Okay, so the point is, that's an if and only if statement. If you ever see an additive utility function defined over several attributes, you've implied multi-attribute risk neutrality. The most common setting there is in intertemporal decision making, where one attribute is money today, the other's in the future. When we write out the usual intertemporal utility function, it's additive, that's implying you're ruling out multi-attribute risk aversion over time. All right, so we have to, here's our non-separable utility function. There's the single attribute utility function for scarcity, the single attribute utility function for sanitation. Eta is the thing that makes these non-additive, and then we assume it's additive in the utility function for money. So these are simple constant relative risk aversion. I'm going to give you summary results in 30 seconds using expected utility theory. We've also got it done with rank-dependent utility. That's not the issue here. That's an interesting, important layer, but it's not critical. So here are the results. We find single attribute risk aversion for each attribute. So the SARA is single attribute risk aversion, if you take them one at a time. So if you're a water sanitation charity and you're a water scarcity charity, and it'd be hard, think about it, it's going to be hard to actually separate those two. Imagine that you're providing water. The subjects will still have some belief about, well, what's the quality of that water compared to the other water? So it's actually hard to be a single attribute charity in the minds of the subjects, because they're thinking something about the other attributes, right? But we find that people are risk averse on each of those attributes. That's not a big surprise or shock. We do find that risk aversion of money and non-money attributes differs. And in fact, we find people are much more risk averse over money than they are over scarcity or sanitation. And we actually find that people are multi-attribute risk loving. Nothing wrong with that. What that suggests is, to me, that's a preference that says they want to see the attributes get above some threshold. They want to go for the extremes. If I make a contribution and I make a modest change in scarcity and sanitation, I value more getting it above some certain level. So I value the extremes. That's a completely coherent, sensible preference, it seems to me, but it is what the data says. Okay, let me draw the implications of the specific findings. We find that risk of charitable outcomes can matter. That's kind of intuitive, but it's something that's often neglected, that these are subjective lotteries in the minds of the individuals. I think this is also true for warm glow giving. I think there's attributes that go with warm glow giving as well. So even there, it's not unidimensional. We also note that familiar concepts of decision-making under risk can inform observed charitable giving patterns. Why might we be interested in this if you're a practitioner? Right now, you're not interested in it. The reason you're interested in it, because there's only a finite number of John Lists and Uri Genesis that can go out and match your charity with a couple of good ideas. There's a lot of brilliant graduate students around and bright young things around, but two things are going to happen. One, all of the interesting little marketing perturbations are going to get done and published after a while. As good as John and Uri are, and I'm absolutely jealous of their ability to write stuff up brilliantly, I really am actually, there's a limit on the return that they're going to get, and their graduate students are going to be get trying things out. After a while, what we need are insights that are transferable, that are not specific to this charity or specific to that charity. We need to learn something about, guess what, the science of philanthropy, not just what works here and what works there. I actually despise the expression evidence-based and what works, because it's eschewing structural knowledge that might transfer from one charity to another charity, but that's a debate for another day. Clearly, we've shown that multiple attributes associated with a charity can matter. That's not too surprising. I've been avoiding you, but I'm still on time. If I keep going, that's wonderful. Okay, so let me just talk about briefly some limitations. In fact, Dan pointed out one of the limitations that we're assuming the credibility of the induced production. What, have I got to stop now? That's okay. There are some limitations of what we're doing. Final conclusions, you can read them. I'm happy to take questions. Uri. Yes and no. Because I'm an economist, that's the usual answer. No. So that's it. That's exactly right. And for example, some of the skill sets, and we talked about this dealing with, my own belief, and I think many of the practitioners would share this, the skill sets that apply for the high donors are completely separate than the skill sets for the general donors. That's psychology. That's you were talking about that the other day. I think those sorts of skill sets travel very, very well. You're a person. You can talk to people. You can get them engaged in the charity and so forth. I think a lot of the other things, there's a mixture of things that travel and don't travel. That's actually part of the science. What insights travel to different, very, very different types of charities, and which ones don't? That's going to be an exciting applied exercise for this current generation of scholars to look at. And I think both of our priors are some will travel, some will not. And what we would love to be guided by is, why don't these ones travel? Can we have some clues why they do and why they don't? Yes.
So you're talking a lot about the moderates. Don't you think that the members of the LGS are actually ambiguous?
Yeah.
So ambiguity.
Yeah, actually.
More than
absolutely, absolutely, absolutely. The moment we start using the language of lotteries, we need to distinguish between risk, uncertainty, and ambiguity. What a lot of people call ambiguity is actually uncertainty. It's just been misnamed in the literature. So uncertainty is when you've got a subjective PDF distribution over outcomes. And you don't, and the shape of the distribution matters. You don't boil it down with reduction of compound lotteries. Ambiguity is where you don't have the information to fill in that subjective PDF. My concern is that there's no such thing as ambiguity because you never know what the subject says. If you run an Ellsberg experiment, the subject might make some assumptions, in which case they're turning it into a game of uncertainty. I completely agree. One of the great joys of what my co-authors have done with this design is we can now start asking those questions. Yes?
So
sorry, sir.
Did you do the research
failed
skills that happened to the same?
Yep.
In that case, you talk about risk factors and ambiguity factors about something that doesn't affect the person directly at all.
No. Their choices cause certain outcomes to be made through the donations. And we can... Yeah. But hold, stop. Let me make my point. There's no reason to restrict it to choices over things that happen to themselves. When I have an investment fund manager, he or she makes decisions over my portfolio that affect me. I can still study the risk aversion that investment fund manager obtains. So there's no reason we can't have his arguments other... Sure. I agree, and I'll keep the answer very brief. That's why it's very, very important to try to break things down into attributes. Those of you who are as old as I am will remember the old characteristics literature in demand theory, that we might want to break down a TV set, black and white color, into the characteristics attributes. It's nothing different than that. The reason we do that is to be able to allow insights about characteristics that we think are more primitive to different products that embody them in different ways. I'll leave it there because I want to be fair on the other people as well. Okay, thank you.